Well, hello and welcome to the Northern Illawarra Uniting Church sermon for this week, September 10th. And we're continuing our sermon series on the Lord's Prayer, how Jesus teaches us and his disciples to pray. We're reading it from the account in the Gospel of Luke, found in Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. Let me read it for us. You'll see it on the screen. Jesus was praying in a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples." And he said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us, and do not bring us to the time of trial.'" Well, that's the shortened version of the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Now, a number of years ago, I served at a church. It was called Fifth Avenue Presbyterian Church, right in Manhattan, New York City. A big church in the big city, one of the great historical churches. And Fifth Avenue is kind of the center of the world, especially for the people who live there. They think it's the center of the world. And people love Fifth Avenue. People come from all over the world to visit it, partly because it's a mecca of shopping and fashion. But the thing I loved most about Fifth Avenue was not the shops, but as I walked down to my job every week, it was that this was home to some of the most amazing buildings, especially churches. Not just Fifth Avenue Presbyterian Church, St. Patrick's Cathedral was on that road, and also another church called St. Thomas's Episcopal Church. Every one of these churches, amazing. And it's St. Thomas's Episcopal Church, which is the backdrop of one of my personal favorite pictures. I'll put it up on the screen here. The picture is by Norman Rockwell. You may have heard of him. He's an American artist and I think has done more than anyone else in the 20th century to capture something about everyday life. He was famous for his covers to the Saturday Evening Post magazine. Now look at this picture. It's a typical New York image. People moving down Fifth Avenue. But if you look at the bottom of the picture, heads down, distracted, depressed, bored and busy. Now, this is a scene that has taken place a number of decades ago, but it probably looks, maybe the clothing looks a little bit different. People may have earbuds in, but it's basically the same picture. Everyone looking down, focused on their own business. But as they go by in this picture, the church custodian preps the church sign for the coming week. A verse from the book of Isaiah. "Lift up thine eyes," it reads. It's from Isaiah chapter 40. And the genius of Rockwell is that everything in the picture draws our eyes up, not just to the sign, but up further, the stairs, the ladder, the railings, the arches, the birds flying into the sky, so that we ourselves, as we look at the picture, ascend above the busy street to wonder and beauty. And it's all right there for the people walking on the street, if only they would lift up their eyes. You know, I sometimes have the same feeling walking around the Northern Illawarra. I moved here about 2 years ago back here, and sometimes I walk around with my head down, focused on my own business, my own problems, my own phone. But in a moment, I lift up my eyes and I see the wonders of the escarpment, galahs and lorikeets, the golden sun on the ocean and the lazy clouds drifting up through the ridges, the beauty and the wonder that puts me in my place, puts my problems in their perspective, and fills me just in that moment with a sense of wonder and worship. Last week, as we began teaching on the Lord's Prayer, we talked about the invitation into prayer. Father, hallowed be your name. And Jesus holds these two things together. Father means that we are safe. Hallowed be your name means that we are invited to encounter the living God. These first two lines connect us to the intimacy and the awesomeness of God. Now this week, I want to move to the next two lines. They're not usually connected in teaching. Your kingdom come and give us this day our daily bread. Usually, this is the section when you're reading it in church that we take a breath. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Deep breath, pause, moving on. Give us this day our daily bread. But I love the way that Luke records the prayer. These two ideas are so closely linked together. Simply, your kingdom come and give us today our daily bread. And I think for Jesus, these two phrases actually are deeply connected, and we must read them together. And it's these two phrases, precisely put together and precisely in this order, that invite us to lift up our eyes. When I pray that God's kingdom would come, What I'm invited to do is lift up my eyes from my own concerns. Because if I'm honest, left to my own devices, my prayers will be maintenance prayers. Maintenance prayers are prayers focused on what fixing what is. Prayers for my family, prayers for my church, prayers for a job or a crisis or health or whatever challenges I and my friends are facing. Maintenance prayers are prayers about our problems, my problems and needs. Maintenance prayers are for God's blessing on my thing. And if I'm honest, you know, these prayers tend to be short and mechanical and focused on the physical needs inside the church. Now, we should pray maintenance prayers. I pray them almost every day for my family, for this church, and we pray them together each Sunday. But that's not the way Jesus starts his prayer. He begins with that wonderful phrase, "Thy kingdom come." May God's kingdom come. Jesus is teaching us here to pray not just maintenance prayers, but kingdom prayers. To begin my prayer with not my plans, my goals, or my interests, but with the kingdom of God that is coming. The kingdom of God is the heart of Jesus' message. Not a new regime of religious activity or a religion or a ticket to heaven, but the kingdom of God is the extension of God's reign and rule over the whole world. And when the King of Heaven has his way, then everything begins to be put right. Not just our religious life or our spiritual life or our own personal life, but the whole world starts to be put to rights. So we could ask with our imagination, what does the kingdom look like as it comes here in Bulleye? Maybe it's a place where generosity is the watchword. People freely give the excess of what they have and see their investments and homes as gifts to be given, not assets to be hoarded. Where work is a joyful task and full of dignity, from the canteen lady to the council person, everybody is honored for the work that they do. Our community might recognize its wealth and look for ways to creatively bless other, less fortunate communities around the world. And the immigrants and the refugees that come here are given the help they need to make a new home and cared for. Conflicts are resolved with forgiveness and wisdom and clarity. Young people are challenged and mentored, not crushed by debt. Old people are honored and supported. The lonely find reasons to laugh and celebrate. People with mental illness and physical disability are not shunned, but are welcomed, tended to, and empowered. And even death is met as one more step of trust in God. And in this place where the kingdom of God is coming, yes, we imagine that churches are full of people praying and worshiping, studying and fellowshipping, not out of guilt or obligation, but because people want to live at peace with each other, within themselves, and with God. Friends, catching a vision of what God's kingdom looks like as it comes to the world. In fact, when the King of Heaven rules this world, in one sense, if you think about it, the rest of Jesus' prayer is answered. The hungry do have their daily bread. Everyone has enough. Debts are forgiven. People are released. No more debt. The Jubilee year. And the victim is saved from the evil one and the unjust trial. Now, even as I describe it, we catch a glimpse of such a world. We might dismiss it as mere optimism, but we catch a glimpse of it, right? We see God's kingdom coming, but pretty quickly, our eyes drop. Most of the time, I don't lift my eyes to look for such a kingdom, to ask for it. And so my imagination for such a kingdom starts to atrophy and wither. I'm so busy, focused on my own troubles, I can't even imagine what God's kingdom would look like in this place in a real way. So this is what Jesus is asking us to do in the prayer, to lift our eyes up and look for the kingdom that is coming, to see signs of it, to ask for it, to long for it. And that takes practice, to be practiced people at looking for the kingdom of God, placing God's goals above my own individual priorities, to practice finding and being the kingdom, or at least a sign of it. So here's the beautiful thing, that just by praying kingdom prayers, the kingdom begins to come. Because God's kingdom does not come with an army or a political revolution or a bulldozer. God's kingdom comes like a seed in the ground, your heart and maybe mine, growing life in the hearts of people just like you and me. So what does it mean to pray these kingdom prayers? Kingdom prayers tend to begin with a sense of our own weakness, our own maladjustment from God's kingdom. When I kneel to pray, "Your kingdom come," I can't help but think how far I fall short of the vision of the kingdom, how much I don't fit in with what that new kingdom would be. I become aware of how unkingdom I am. And so as I pray kingdom prayers, I start to repent, not out of fear or worry, but really out of grief that I am so ill-suited to God's kingdom. So there's a sense of repentance. There's a sense of grief that comes with these kingdom prayers, grieved over my lack of love and my endurance to serve. But this repentance comes with a request, asking God to make me more fit for his kingdom. So kingdom prayers involve a sense of repentance, but they also are bold and specific. I start to look and long for God's kingdom work, not just a small healing there or a small job offer there, but to see God's work in my life and in the world. And to pray kingdom prayers means to be patient and enduring, because these are big prayers. They will not come overnight like a seed growing in the ground. It will take time. But that's the kind of prayer that Jesus invites us to. That's what it means to pray, "Thy kingdom come." The sustained discipline of focused attention on God's purposes and God's coming kingdom. And Jesus says, put those prayers first. Before you pray for your daily bread, your daily needs, put kingdom prayers first. And do you see now why Jesus puts such prayers first, that the prayer for daily bread comes after the prayer for the kingdom? I think it's because Jesus knows us. Jesus knows, firstly, that the immediate fear when we start to put the kingdom of God first in our minds, we're fearful. The same fear that the disciples had in the storm or when they were asked to feed the 5,000. You're asking us to give, Jesus. You're asking us to trust, but don't you care about us? Don't you see what we need? Does God care only about the spiritual and not the physical? Well, of course not, says Jesus. God knows what we need. So Jesus tells us, as soon as you pray for the kingdom, don't be afraid to pray for your needs as well. Pour out your heart. It's very similar to what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, just after he teaches on the Lord's Prayer, actually, when he says, "Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you." But the order matters. Put the kingdom first, and then ask for our needs. I want to be clear here because this can be misunderstood. It's for our good that Jesus puts the prayer in this order. Because if we pray for our needs first, there will be no end to them. The needs before us will fill our vision and we'll never quite getting around to lifting up our eyes to see the goodness of God. Our eyes are always drawn down. And so Jesus says, start by looking up. There'll be plenty of time. Look, we all know, you and I know that we have more than enough. Objectively, realistically, we look at our lives and we go, we have more than enough. But it never feels like enough. But if you pray kingdom prayers, your vision of God, your trust in God will grow, your sense of God's goodness will grow, and our worries will diminish in comparison. The prayer for my needs and your needs will take their proper place. Put needs first, they will never be felt. Put God first, and everything else will find its place. This is so clear, I think everywhere, but especially here in our community in the Northern Illawarra. Basically, we live in one of the wealthiest places on earth. But as we look around, do we see people deeply satisfied? No, of course not. Because humans need bread, we need homes, we need clothing. Of course, our Father in heaven knows we need all these things, but human beings need more than bread. We are made for God's kingdom. It's our purpose. There's no shortage of daily bread around here, but there is a poverty of purpose, a famine of meaning. Jesus is blessing us by saying that we need the kingdom more than we need bread. We need to ask for God's presence before we ask for our daily bread. You know, there's a beautiful moment in the Gospel of John, John chapter 4, when Jesus meets the Samaritan woman by the well and has a deep and meaningful conversation with her. He sent his disciples out to go and get lunch while he spends hours with this woman, counseling her, helping her find her purpose, connecting her to God and blessing her. It's a beautiful, deep, spiritual conversation. And when the disciples come back with food, they're surprised to see Jesus talking with this woman and they urge him to eat some lunch. It's been hours. But Jesus looks at them and says, I have food to eat that you don't know about. Jesus, the true human, is telling us that he's full. He's satisfied because he's seeing the kingdom of God coming in this place and in this time. Jesus wants to know that food, daily bread, the soul nourishing food of joining God in the purposes of the kingdom, is the food that truly satisfies us. Jesus doesn't put the kingdom first and the bread second to deprive us. Jesus puts the kingdom first so that our souls will be satisfied, so that every bite of bread that we take will be more nourishing and it will be enough. May his kingdom come. May we lift up our eyes and may we all be fed until our souls and our bodies are satisfied. In the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.